So once again, we consider the fun subject of discrete calculus. Yay. Like to hear it. You could call it, if you want to be extra fancy about it, calculus sans limits. What's sans? Well, it's a French word for without. Okay, so if you want to say without in a fancy way, say sans, or is it sans? I don't even know. Sans. Calculus sans limits. Sorry that I mangled the French. And we did talk about both the forward difference operator and the backward difference operator last week. And I want to mostly focus today on the forward difference operator. And the forward difference operator, delta of Pn is Pn plus 1 minus Pn. And again, the backwards difference operator is not that much different, pun intended. It's just a shifting of the subscripts, essentially. You define this for n equals 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. when our original sequence Pn is defined starting with n equals 0. And with the backwards difference operator, nabla of Pn, I'll go ahead and mention it again, the backwards difference operator, nabla of Pn is really, well, it's technically a different formula and you technically use it for different values of n starting with 1 instead of 0. But because that, because you're doing differences of successive values in the sequence, it's really the same sequence, just, again, reordered with the first element of the sequence being a subscript of 0, of 0 in the first case and 1 in the second case. Anyway, we talked last time about how these act like derivatives and that, for example, you could compute the forward difference operator applied to n cubed and see what we get. And we did this last time, but let's do the calculation real quick again. You get n plus 1 cubed minus n cubed. Expand that out with the binomial theorem. Cancel the n cubes and you're left with 3n squared plus 3n plus 1. Not 3n squared, as in calculus, if n were a continuous variable and we were taking an ordinary derivative, but similar enough that it makes you happy, I guess, that it's acting kind of like regular, ordinary calculus. But you might wonder, is there, so this is not quite the power rule from calculus, is there an analog of the power rule that works better? Where you just, you do bring down the exponent and subtract 1 from it. And the answer is yes, there is an analog. And the analog is that instead of raising n to a particular positive integer power, k, you raise it to the falling power of k. That's called a falling power. But what in the world is a falling power? It's not n times itself, k times. It's n times n minus 1 times n minus 2 times n minus 3 times, etc. Hey, this kind of feels familiar, doesn't it? Kind of like factorials and binomial coefficients. What's the last factor in this product? You want to have k factors since the first factor is n minus 0 and the second factor is n minus 1. Third factor is n minus 2. The k factor must be n minus k minus 1, which could be expanded to n minus k plus 1. I want to compute delta of this thing. I forgot my delta. What would that be? Well, use the definition of delta, the forward difference operator. I guess you get, replace all those n's with n plus 1's. N plus 1. N plus 1 minus 1 is just an n. N plus 1 minus 2 is n minus 1. N plus 1 minus 3 is n minus 2. Dot, dot, dot. I guess the last one would be replace n with n plus 1. I get n plus 1 minus k plus 1. I guess that's n minus k plus 2. That would be n plus 1 to the falling k power. I need to subtract n to the falling k power. And I would get the exact same thing, except the n plus 1 at the beginning would be gone. And the last one would be n minus k plus 1. Now, I can't cancel things here because these are products, but I can factor out a common factor. What's the common factor? The common factor would be this product there and there. That can be factored out like this. And then what's left over from the first term is an n plus 1, and from the second term is an n minus k plus 1. The n's cancel, the 1's cancel, and this simplifies to negative of negative k is k. Huh. Yeah, is that right? Yep, that is right. And what's this thing? So what do I have? I have k times n to, that's a falling power. What falling power? How many factors are in that falling power? 1, 2, 3 through, what am I subtracting here? Really, this is the same as n minus, in parentheses, k minus 2. I've got k minus 1 factors there. That's n to the falling k minus 1 power. Hey, doesn't this look cool? The discrete forward difference derivative of n to the falling k power. Bring down the k, not as a falling k, but as an ordinary k, times n to the falling k minus 1 power. So there's the better form of the discrete power rule. You like it, David? Go ahead and clap louder. Okay. There we go. Discrete power rule. You might wonder, is this useful? Let's see if we can figure out whether it's useful. We'll get there. Not right now. Okay, we'll do applications when we talk about discrete integration, which we're about to talk about in a few minutes. Before we talk about discrete integration, though, we should remind you that there are other properties. There's a linearity rule. The forward difference operator applied to a linear combination, alpha times Pn plus beta times Qn, is just like an ordinary calculus, the first constant, alpha times the derivative of the first function, plus the second constant, beta times the derivative of the second function, derivative being discrete derivative here. There's also a product rule and quotient rule. You might wonder whether there's also a chain rule. I'm not going to talk about the chain rule. Yes, there is a product rule and a quotient rule. I'm afraid I'm going to write them down wrong, though, if I try to write them from memory. So let's look at what I have in here. The discrete product rule can be written like this as one way it can be written. It's not a unique way. The discrete derivative, the forward difference of Pn times Qn, is the first function at n plus 1, not n, times the quote-unquote derivative of the second function, plus the derivative of the first function times the second function. So I'm putting an n plus 1 subscript there and an n subscript there. But wait a minute. Shouldn't the roles of P and Q be symmetric here? I mean, what if I switch their roles around? Yeah, they are symmetric. So an alternative way to write it is to have an n here and an n plus 1 there. They would simplify to the same thing. Here's a verification. No limits, calculus sans limits. Just calculate this thing, expand it out, and lo and behold, you get that when you simplify. Okay, how would you discover this in the first place? That would take some experimentation to figure this out in the first place. Yes, an alternative product rule is where you replace this with n and this with n plus 1. There's actually another alternative product rule, but it's more complicated. Looks like that. You might want to take the time to double check that all these calculations work. That one looks different and perhaps wrong, but it all does work out in the end. And you can check it with examples. An is this sequence, Bn is the sequence, Pn is their product. I could have used P's and Q's here instead. Here's the discrete derivative of A, 6 plus 2n, the discrete derivative of B. Notice A is a quadratic and B is a cubic, so their derivatives, their discrete derivatives are linears and quadratics. Their product would be a fifth degree. What's its discrete derivative? It's a fourth degree. And yes, if you use the original form of that product rule, you do get the exact same thing. These last two expressions here and here are the exact same thing, confirming it for this example. There is a discrete quotient rule that you can confirm with an example as well. Is it low d high minus high d low over the square of what's below? Almost. Instead of squaring what's below, you multiply qn and qn plus 1. You can use the falling power fact to find, for example, the discrete derivative of n cubed in a different way. How? Through a bit of trickery. N cubed is not a falling power, but you can relate it to a falling power. How? Well, let's compute n to the third falling power. That would be n times n minus 1 times n minus 2. Expand that out, that'll be n times, in parentheses, n squared minus 3n plus 2. Continuing to expand, that'll be n cubed minus 3n squared plus 2n. And because of that, therefore, n cubed, you can solve this equation for n cubed and write it as n to the third falling power plus 3n squared minus 2n, right? Just take this equation and solve for n cubed. And this equation can be used to find the discrete derivative of n cubed, if you like. I have put this on old exams, I think. How? Well, use linearity. This would be the discrete derivative of n to the third falling power plus 3 times the discrete derivative of n squared plus or minus 2 times the discrete derivative of n. The power rule for falling power says delta of n to the falling third power is 3 times n to the falling second power. Right? Right there. I just used the fact that we talked about 5 minutes ago, 3 minutes ago. Plus 3 times, what's this? Well, we didn't compute this today, but we did the other day. I remember it off the top of my head. I think it was 2n plus 1. 2n plus 1. We did that actually last week, the discrete derivative of n squared. You can compute it out. Not quite 2n, it's 2n plus 1. Minus 2, what's the discrete derivative of n itself? It's n plus 1 minus n, it's just 1. Now simplify this. N to the second falling power is n times n minus 1. Expand this out. Continue simplifying. 3n squared minus 3n plus 6n plus 1. We're almost done. 3n squared plus 3n plus 1. Is that the same thing we got on the other piece of paper? Yes, it is, right there, that we did 10 minutes ago. We got the same answer. In a, what you might say is maybe a more fun way, using linearity and using the power rule for falling powers. Actually, this may indeed be a better way to go once you've found these discrete derivatives for n, then n squared, then n cubed, then n to the fourth, then n to the fifth, then n to the sixth, for example. might be a better way to find the discrete derivative into the seventh, this method. Okay, kind of a fun little method using properties of these discrete derivatives that I think I have put on exams before.